In the day's other news, the United States declared a public health emergency over the coronavirus outbreak. China has now confirmed more than 11,000 cases and nearly 250 deaths. The U.S. confirmed a seventh case today. In Washington, the Secretary of Health and Human Services, Alex Azar, said the U.S. is barring foreigners who recently traveled to China and is working to corral the outbreak.
Most important thing that we can be doing is what we are doing, which is offering to help the Chinese government and assist them in helping them to control the spread of the novel coronavirus in China, working with them as closely as possible, as well as with the World Health Organization. Second, the risk to Americans is low.
Nearly 200 Americans who were flown back from China this week will stay quarantined at a military base in Southern California for 2 weeks. The State Department also warned Americans not to travel to China, and Delta and American Airlines have suspended all flights to and from China. Fears of economic fallout from the virus sparked a new sell-off on Wall Street. The Dow Jones Industrial Average slumped more than 600 points to close at 28,256, down 2%. The Nasdaq fell 148 points, and the S&P 500 gave up 58 points. The Trump administration added six countries today to its list of nations subject to travel restrictions into the United States. They are Eritrea, Kyrgyzstan, Myanmar, Nigeria, Sudan, and Tanzania. Citizens of those nations will face new requirements on whether they can enter the U.S. We'll get the details after the news summary. Britain has officially left the European Union tonight after 3.5 years of political wrangling. Prime Minister Boris Johnson celebrated the event amid continuing questions about fallout from Brexit. Gary Gibbon of Independent Television News has our report.
Have you split the country in two over Brexit, Prime Minister?
Well, wait.
Prime Minister, if you could lean in a little bit, that would be lovely.
A symbolic cabinet meeting in Sunderland, where Leave triumphed and where Brexit swung Labour votes to the Tories last month.
You need a block and tackle to get me out.
On Monday, in a speech, the Prime Minister will say he wants a trade deal like Canada has with the EU, openly acknowledging for the first time that approach means expensive delays as products are checked at the border to the EU. The government's estimates and the consensus amongst economists is that will hurt areas like the northeast. In Brussels, the UK's EU office lowered its EU flag. Its staff numbers now go up with the extra pressures of being outside the EU club. That club today put on a show of chin-up unity.
As the sun rises tomorrow, a new chapter for our union of 27 will start.
Whitehall was lit up this evening. The day of the referendum, civil servants spoke of distress and despair. Back then, nearly three-quarters of all MPs backed Remain.
We're one of the biggest economies in the world, perhaps the sixth biggest economy in the world. We can make a success of the choice that we make, and I'm sure that's exactly what we will do. And I wish the government well in all their endeavours to make sure that happens.
A couple of hundred pro-Remain demonstrators serenaded the EU's office in London. One said, "We'll be back." The EU officials look touched, not convinced.
That report from Gary Gibbon of Independent Television News. Israeli troops clashed with Palestinians today as they protested the Trump administration's peace plan that heavily favors Israel. In the West Bank, soldiers fired tear gas and stun grenades at protesters who threw stones. In Gaza, thousands of Palestinians took to the streets and burned Israeli flags. In Australia, the National Capital Region around Canberra has declared an emergency as a major wildfire burns out of control. It is the first fire emergency for the area since 2003. Since Monday, the fire on the city's southern fringe has charred more than 53,000 acres, scorching plant and wildlife. Officials say the situation is only getting worse.
The fire activity is increasing. It has been unpredictable. It remains challenging. It is difficult to access. This fire could create its own weather system.
Extreme heat and drought have fed one of Australia's worst fire seasons on record. At least 33 people have been killed and more than 3,000 homes destroyed since September. Back in this country, President Trump ended limits on the use of landmines outside the Korean Peninsula. The policy dated from the Obama era. U.S. officials said the move addresses a potential conflict with China or Russia. Advocacy groups cited the long history of landmines killing and maiming civilians, even after war's end. A woman accusing Harvey Weinstein of rape testified today at his trial in New York. Actress Jessica Mann cried as she said the former movie mogul raped her in a New York hotel room in 2013. She said if he heard the word no, it was like a trigger. Weinstein's lawyers say the relationship was consensual. And another Democrat has quit the presidential race just ahead of the Iowa caucuses on Monday. Former Congressman John Delaney of Maryland dropped out today. He had campaigned as a moderate but failed to gain any traction. 11 Democrats are still running. Still to come on the NewsHour, the Trump administration expands the reach of its controversial travel ban. On the ground in Iowa, where caucus goers are gearing up to make a choice. David Brooks and Ruth Marcus break down the latest from the Senate impeachment trial. Plus, remembering Jim Lehrer, memories of our friend and co-founder as we say goodbye.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.